Kenneth Kaunda, now president of Zambia, was a school teacher in the British colony of Northern Rhodesia.
USA was born through a revolution. And I felt then that their support for the colonial people's struggles for independence was based on their own experience.
In principle, that was true. America did favor independence. But again and again, U.S. sentiment favoring anti-colonialism collided head-on with the new imperative of anti-communism, as in French Indochina. George Elsie was an aide in the Truman White House when that question came up.
At least initially, you had to give the French a hand. But the way to keep communism from spreading in Southeast Asia was to support the French, at least on a temporary basis.
And the British Empire, too, was falling apart. The empire on which the sun never set withdrew from India and Southeast Asia. British influence declined in the Persian Gulf and the Middle East. In the Middle East, Jewish underground groups were fighting the British army to establish an independent state for themselves. European Jews had suffered a particular horror during the war because of their religion. Now they wanted a homeland in Palestine. State Department experts recommended against a Jewish state, but President Truman resisted their arguments about protecting oil reserves and possible Jewish-Arab warfare.
The United States recognizes the provisional government as the de facto authority of the new state of Israel.
The neighboring Arab states objected violently. Israel, with its Muslim shrines, was as holy to them as to the Jews. As a result of this and subsequent Middle Eastern wars, millions of Palestinians would eventually become refugees in the Arab world and make their own demands, politically and with terrorism. It was 1948. There were plenty of crises overseas, but the American public was caught up with the post-war boom, especially the baby boom.
When you're smiling, when you're smiling, the whole world smiles with you. When you're laughing, when you're laughing, the sun comes shining through. But when you're crying, you bring on the rain. So stop your sighing, be happy again, keep on smiling. 'Cause when you're smiling, the whole world smiles with you.
Berlin, 1948. The hated capital of Hitler's Germany was now the center of a new struggle.
Berlin under cold siege in the Cold War. U.S. armored cars patrolling the American sector. Tension mounting as the Soviet type...
Berlin was cut off from the West. The Soviets blockaded the Autobahn, stopped the trains, cut off the electricity. The West had the choice of standing by and watching West Berlin move into the Soviet column or running the blockade and the risk of war with the Soviet Union. The policy of containment was being tested. The
question was, should we put American troops on trains and have the train move into Berlin? I was for putting them in. I felt certain that we had the bomb and Stalin didn't. And that he would never shoot Americans off the train.
The only way left to supply Berlin without confrontation was by plane. Every day, the airlift supplied tons of milk, flour, and coal. Everything needed to keep Berlin alive. Sir Freddie Laker was one of the pilots.
Occasionally, there were the MiGs would buzz the airplanes, and that was all rather frightening, and they'd come alongside and waggle in their wings. But no one took any notice. No one was going to follow them, for example, as suggested.
As the confrontation dragged on month after month, it reinforced the lesson that communism was a strong menace in Western Europe. But the Soviets, too, were learning something from the airlift. James Callahan was a parliamentary secretary.
The Soviets learned a lesson from that, that the Western democracies were not going to be browbeaten in this particular matter. We had our rights in Berlin, and we have sustained them.
To fight off the threat of Soviet expansionism would take a collective security agreement of European nations and the United States. In the face of the communist danger, the Senate ratified the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, NATO, shortly after the Soviets lifted the Berlin blockade. The satisfaction of having made the Soviets blink first was short-lived. Within 4 months, a B-29 crew on a routine reconnaissance flight in the North Pacific brought back radioactive air samples.
I'll never forget the morning that General Norstad came in and said to me, I have bad news for you. The Soviets have just exploded an atomic weapon. And I said, Laurie, that can't be true. That's not possible. They couldn't have done it based on what everybody said. And he said, well, they've done it.
Someone had passed America's atomic bomb secrets to Russia. This was an undisputed fact that the whole world knew. The federal government had laid the crime at the doorstep of two native New Yorkers, Julius and Ethel Rosenberg.
Their conviction for passing atomic secrets to the Russians and their eventual execution fueled American paranoia and fed the public anti-communist frenzy.
One communist on the faculty of one university is one communist.
You are to appear before the Committee on Un-American Activity.
No, I intend to name names.
Their allegiance is to Russia.
Are you a member of the Communist
Stand
Party?
Away from the
or
stand.
Have you ever been a member of the Communist Party?
Stand away from the stand.
Fight for the Bill of Rights which
you
are going to
destroy. Stand away from the stand.
This pig, J. Parnell Thomas, congressman, who was a real monster, who was sitting up there with his gavel.
Mr. Stripling, the next witness.
As they'd started to open their mouths, the gavel. Are you now, or have you ever been a member of the Communist Party? You know, I mean, it's unbelievable.
Tense drama grips a hearing of the House Un-American Activities Committee.
Mr. Hiss is lying.
Alger Hiss was accused of spying for the communists.
He was a top member of the State Department bureaucracy. That somebody in those positions could have been or had communist sympathies.
Senator Joseph McCarthy.
I have in my hand checks.
The actions of the junior senator from Wisconsin have caused alarm and dismay amongst our allies abroad and given considerable comfort to our enemies. And whose fault is that? Not really his. He didn't create this situation of fear, he merely exploited it.
Edward R. Murrow's broadcast was the beginning of the end of McCarthyism. But the anti-communist investigations gave Richard Nixon anti-communist credentials, which would serve him well in future years. As World War II was ending, first Roosevelt and then Truman at Potsdam had tried to get the Soviets to open an Asian front against Japan. When the war was over and the Japanese were defeated, it was understood that Moscow was entitled to some of the spoils of war. But where? Not Japan. China was an ally. It was agreed that they would get a piece of Korea. But where would the line be drawn?
In the middle of the night one night, another colonel and I were sent into an adjoining room to propose a specific line, and we looked at a map of Korea, thought that it would be good if the capital, Seoul, were in our sector, so-called. So we looked north of Seoul, and there were no clear distinguishing geographic features that we could use, but there was the 38th parallel. And so we recommended the 38th parallel, and the Russians accepted that with alacrity, somewhat to our surprise. Well, neither the State Department nor military people who were present at that meeting knew that at the beginning of this century, the Russians and the Japanese had been negotiating about spheres of influence in Korea along the 38th parallel. Had we known that, we would have selected any other line, because that undoubtedly meant to the Russians that we were accepting their sphere of influence north of the 38th parallel, and that any talk about the unification of Korea was just froth on the cake. So it turned out to have been a mistake, partly through the ignorance of those present about the earlier history of the 38th parallel in Korea.